Okay. One, two, three. Okay, hello, folks. Let's start. Our today's talk is about Sahara. Sahara is a project that brings Hadoop to OpenStack. Today's presenters are myself, Sergey Lukjanov. I'm the principal software engineer in Mirantis and project technical lead of data processing program. That includes Project Sahara in OpenStack. The next speaker is Matthew Farrellee from Red Hat and John from Hortonworks. So our agenda is a brief overview of Sahara project, highlights from Icehouse release, overview of HDP plugin, and a brief overview of Juno plans. Okay, so the mission of the data processing program is to make some scalable, elastic provisioning of data processing tools and a number of operations on top of them. So in Sahara, for foreseeable future, we were supporting Hadoop on top of OpenStack and two levels of operations for Hadoop. Provision and operate Hadoop clusters, and then on top of these provisioned clusters, provisioning, scheduling, and operations for Hadoop jobs. So in the future, we will grow to support other data processing tools, not only Hadoop. But for now, as I say, we are working with Hadoop and Hadoop ecosystem. A bit about the Hadoop. It's not just a single project. It's something like the OpenStack. It's based on the two core services named HDFS, Hadoop Distributed File System, and Yarn. And there are tons of different services and tools on top of two core Hadoop projects. There are some projects for streaming processing, for DSLs, for running MapReduce jobs, and et cetera. Let's take a look on the question why you think that it's a good idea to bring Hadoop to OpenStack. So as you can see, there are three lines. The blue line is OpenStack growth. The red one is about Apache Hadoop, and the yellow one is Amazon Elastic Compute Cloud. Elastic Amazon Cloud contains a product named EMR. That's something like our concept of elastic data processing in Sahara. And as you can see, Apache Hadoop was started much earlier than OpenStack, but both products have the same angle of growth. And that's why we think that it's a very good idea to merge our communities and to bring Hadoop to OpenStack. So let's talk a bit about use cases. The first main central use case of the Sahara is to self-service provision elastic clusters. This elasticity provides end users ability to not keep thousands nodes Hadoop clusters on hardware and just add, remove nodes on demand. So this use case creates a new use case like dev staging and production life cycle use case, when you can just create clusters of the same configuration, same topology, but different size or different compute power for development, Q&A, and production, using the same tool, same cloud, or different regions of one cloud, and et cetera. And one more central to this use case is running Hadoop workloads on top of the created clusters. You can run workloads on top of the existing clusters, on transient clusters too. So let's take a look on the architecture. We have a Horizon plugin that provides users an ability to control and operate Sahara service using the OpenStack dashboard. It's currently implemented as a plugin for dashboards, and we are going to merge it into the Horizon during the Juno cycle. We're using Keystone for authentication, and We are using currently heat for resources provisioning, and that's how we are provisioning resources for OpenStack cluster, like instances, volumes, networks, and etc. Additionally, a very big functionality of Sahara is implemented file system for Hadoop that supports accessing data in Swift directly without any proxies or something like this. That means that you can specify some data sources in Swift and use them from the Hadoop cluster provisioned by Sahara. Let's take some notes about current status of Sahara in OpenStack. We are officially integrated OpenStack project, and we just released our first aligned release named Icehouse in time with all of the OpenStack projects. Matt will make some highlights for it. We have a bunch of supported Hadoop distros. The first one is a vanilla Apache Hadoop. It's just a simple installation of vanilla Hadoop with some tooling on top of it. It's made mostly for the reference. The second distro is a Hortonworks Data Platform. And then we have Intel distribution of Hadoop 2. It's currently closed and we are in the process of merging into the Cloudera distribution that is now in the blueprint. Additionally, we have on review implementation of Spark. It is not a Hadoop, and it's really the first non-Hadoop data processing tool in Sahara, I think. Additionally, I'm glad to say that Sahara is included on different OpenStack distros, in Red Hat OpenStack and into the Mirantis OpenStack too. Additionally, I'm glad to say that we have a big community right now, and I'm really glad to see new names in this list. So let's move to the next speaker.
Hi, so I'm Matt. I'm going to talk to you more specifics about what's actually happening in the Icehouse release of Sahara. So if you're not aware, this is actually the fourth release of the project code, the first release where it was called Sahara, and the first release where it was incubating with OpenStack. So through the four releases, we've seen a nice growth of participation and whatnot. In this release, we actually had 142 bugs, which I think was pretty high, nice growth for us. We saw a tremendous amount of blueprints and new features that were added to the code. I'll go through some of those, and then I'll hit off some of the big ones around the workflow management, CLI, and then John will talk about HTTP enhancements. And through that, we actually saw about 32 people who managed to contribute and make their way up to the launchpad metrics for this. If you actually go look at the commit stream that was coming through, there are another dozen people or so that were involved in the project. And all of that, we did it all using basically the standard process. You can't quite see this here, but we're releasing at the same time. It was the first release where we weren't actually doing all the releases ourselves. We were just going through the same system that all the other OpenStack projects do. And I mentioned all these things, and this is actually just a part of what we've been working on. If you go and you look at the client library, or you go and you look at the disk image builder elements, or you go and you look at the puppet modules, you go and look at the dashboard, you see even more contributions and whatnot. So with that, some of the big features that I want to point out to you for the Icehouse release, the first one is our Tempest integration. So everybody who's even remotely familiar with OpenStack knows that OpenStack's really good for maintaining code stability, API stability, code quality. Sahara itself has had a large amount of unit tests and integration tests that have existed through its four releases. This release, we've started pushing things up into Tempest, which will help us maintain even better API stability and integrate even more with the OpenStack infrastructure. So that's good for anybody who wants to use it, plus anybody who wants to develop on it. Second thing that's going to help people who want to develop on it as well is that there's more integration in DevStack. So this helps people who want to do the development, but it also helps the project itself as we want to get into more of the OpenStack gates and whatnot and maintain compatibility there. So the third thing I want to point out here is that in the Icehouse release, we actually did the first release where we pushed all Hadoop 2 plugins into the system. If you're not familiar with Hadoop, there was an architectural shift between Hadoop 1 and Hadoop 2, where Hadoop 1 is pretty much just HDFS and MapReduce and then an ecosystem of projects that interacted or integrated with one of those. And Hadoop 2, it's actually, there's a platform that's provided with the Yarn layer, which is a resource manager, and MapReduce is just one of the frameworks. This will work out pretty well for us as we go forward as a data processing program within OpenStack. And also, having this availability means that everybody who's actually using a Hadoop distribution these days, they're going to be using, if it's Hortonworks, if it's Cloudera, if it's MapR, or whatever, they're going to be using Hadoop 2, and they need to have that functionality when they come to OpenStack. So, just a few other kind of scattershot features that are coming in. We actually released support for HBase. We're building now images for running in your cluster that are using Spark. We've done a lot of work to move our kind of native original provisioning engine to use Heat. The hope is that in, and I guess Sergey will talk about this, but hoping we'll be just switching over to that for Juno. There's also push to add internationalization. We did for folks who don't want to run all their services as root, we added some root wrap stuff in. And then part of the Heat work and part of our kind of like changing our architecture to be more agent-based, we actually have a start of an implementation of a guest agent. So those are kind of high-level features. I want to talk about two kind of big areas. So one of the big areas for Sahara is elastic data processing, or what we call EDP. And basically, this is our take on how you do workflow management, and the goal being to make sure that people can actually come to OpenStack system. They can not have to care about the details of the cluster that they're going to run their work on. They just have their data, and they've got some sort of question they want to answer, and we move them through the system as smoothly as possible. I've got a quote up here from Amazon EMR about how they're actually running millions of these EMR clusters, these workflows on top of EC2. So having this functionality in OpenStack actually brings a workload to OpenStack, which will allow for kind of higher adoption and whatnot, or at least we hope that is the case. So in the Icehouse release updates for EDP, we actually have support through the Hortonworks HDP plugin. Previously, it was primarily through kind of a generic vanilla reference implementation plugin. So this is great. This means that you can set up your HDP cluster, and then you can do all of your workflow through it using Sahara itself. More features that we added there. We started out originally with being able to ingest data from Swift, do the processing, then output it back to Swift. We've now added the ability to use HDFS itself as an input-output, which means if you have long-running clusters, you can continually run workload across them, or even if you have remote clusters, you can ingest from a remote cluster, do processing, and then maybe output to another remote cluster. We've added some new actions, so new types of workload that you can actually run. Previously, it was mostly Pig, Hive, MapReduce. We've added support for MapReduce streaming, and maybe most interesting for like the total hackers in the group, the Java actions, which basically lets you run any program as long as it's Java. It doesn't have to be a specific workload. So there's that, and then in the kind of like long term, we want EDP to be a really smooth and easy to use framework. We've added the ability to relaunch jobs with new inputs, new parameters, so that you don't have to go through the whole process of creating up a template of jobs and whatnot. Okay, so that's EDP. I want to talk to you briefly about the command line interface, which we've added. So goal here is basically to have parity between what you could do with the Horizon dashboard to what you can do with the command line. For a lot of people, at least myself, I tend to gravitate more towards CLIs, which are easier to script and whatnot. This will actually, in the long term, help us be able to do end-to-end testing of the system as well. So in this, you can do everything that you could actually do with the dashboard in sometimes not as smooth a fashion, but we're working on that. When I say not as smooth a fashion, the dashboard UI actually will allow you to do kind of like wizard screens to build up different structures and then like create a cluster and then launch it and whatnot. With the CLI, we kind of do that minimally. We allow import and export of JSON formats. So you can build something with the dashboard, then you could export it to JSON, tweak it a little bit with sed here and there, and then import it again if you wanted. But we cover image management. So this is Sahara's way of associating images in the Glance registry with plugins that Sahara runs to limit the amount of times that people are going to try to run a cluster with an image that's not compatible with. We have all the functionality for node groups and cluster groups and job templates. I mentioned this has more of the JSON input-output, but it's still very functional. We're starting to actually use it in a number of our tests. Handling data sources. If you want to come kind of find us afterwards, I can show you what the typical workflows are like, or if we have time at the end, I've got a nice little slide that describes the workflow. But data sources and job binaries, data sources are things like this Swift container or that HDFS directory, and job binaries are things like this jar file that has this main method and this other jar file that has another main method, that kind of stuff. So, but that can all be built up through the CLI as well. Everything I mentioned before is all set up for these last two commands, being able to actually create clusters and jobs and rerun them, launch them. We'll be adding some more functionality, being able to scale and whatnot coming up. That's it. At this point, I want to hand over to John to talk about HDP.
Thanks, Matt. Hi, my name is John from Hortonworks. Hortonworks provides a plugin to Sahara. Sahara project's very important to Hortonworks. The HDP plugin has been part of Sahara from the beginning of the project. Right now, the HDP plugin provides support for all of the Sahara functionality that we've talked about, Nova, Neutron, scaling up, Swift integration, Cinder support, data locality, and EDP. One of the differentiators for the HDP plugin is that it utilizes Apache Ambari. Apache Ambari is the management framework that's used in the HDP stack. So the way the HDP plugin works is everything goes through the Apache Ambari. It goes through the REST call. It actually goes from provisioning Apache Ambari for you within your VMs based on your topology layout, and then it proceeds to then use Apache Ambari to actually lay out the cluster, start the cluster for you. So more important for the end user is that after your cluster has been started up, you have Apache Ambari available to you for monitoring and managing of your cluster after you've gone ahead and provisioned it. So you can go ahead and you could set up your security with that. You could do monitoring via ganglia. You could add additional nodes if need be, and services, etc. So, you know, you're not just stuck with a cluster that's hard to manage and monitor. You have a nice UI. So there's a couple screenshots to the right there that show some of the, you know, the graphs that are available to you. So that's something we've been working very hard on, is providing good management and monitoring support, and that's available to you here through the plugin. So we're also going to talk about why this is important to us. So Sahara provides the ability to combine the HTTP stack, all the functionality available in the HTTP stack, in an easy-to-use, reusable deployment tool, Sahara, within an OpenStack framework. We also provide several pre-installed images. So we have several HTTP images that you can use for our 1.3 and 2.06 stacks, and they're available on S3. You could also use a generic image. You'll get a little slower startup time, but that way you don't have to have the image pre-populated with HTTP bits. All right, so talking about the HTTP stacks, so we started with one, so we support several stacks. We support 1.3.2, 2.06, and 2.1. 1.3.2 is the older MapReduce name, the MapReduce HDFS type of functionality. Then we moved up into 2.06, where we provided YARN, and 2.1 is going to introduce further Storm and Falcon, and going on, we'll have solar cascading potentially in the near future. So the neat thing with this combination of Sahara and the HTTP plugin is that as you download the latest version of Sahara, you're going to get the latest plugin, which is going to give you the support for the latest HTTP stack. You won't have to do any additional work. So as we add new services to the HTTP stack, they'll become available to users of Sahara through the plugin. All right, so talking a little bit about disk images. So there's a project called the Disk Image Builder that's available. It's a separate project, but it's used by all of the plugins for Sahara to build VM images. It's a consistent API across all the providers to provide you a mechanism to build VM images. HD plugin supports a plain 1.3.2, a 2.06, and soon to be 2.1 preloaded images. So those preloaded images have HTTP bits already installed on them in the form of a local repository, and that improves the startup time of your cluster. Like I said, we also support a plain image where it goes over the wire, and it'll pull those things down if you choose to start out with, say, a plain CentOS image. These scripts also can be customized. So in addition to running the script and getting all the default VM image for, say, our 2.06 stack, you can augment the script to include changes for security, maybe some custom packages you want to add to your VM images, maybe some tweaks, some kernel settings on your OS, et cetera. All right, so I'll talk a little bit about blueprints. So this is a little forward-looking. Blueprints is a mechanism that we use within Apache Ambari to completely describe a cluster in a text JSON format. So this opens up some very interesting use cases between the physical and the virtual world. So what is a blueprint, first of all? It's a complete description of a running cluster. So you'll be able to have a running cluster in a physical world. It's a physical cluster, you've deployed this thing by hand, probably taking you quite a long time to get everything right. You'll be able to then ask Ambari for a blueprint for this running cluster. It'll give you a JSON file that fully describes your running cluster. At that point, you'll be able to take this blueprint and import it into the HTTP plugin and ask it to spin up the same cluster with the same configurations and the same topology. You'll be able to then override any topology specific or any configurations that you feel that you need to override in your virtualized environment. You'll be given a chance to override those when provisioning your cluster. And what this allows you to do is, you know, mimic something you took a lot of time provisioning in your physical world, and then just tell Sahara to deploy this thing, and now you have a replica, if you will, of this cluster in your virtualized world. More importantly, it's repeatable. So now once you have this blueprint, you can then go ahead and provision as many of these clusters as you want based on this blueprint. So some of the things that, you know, we're looking at internally to use this for is maybe a use case where support might use something like this. So we'll get a support ticket filed from one of our customers, and we'll go ahead and ask them, you know, send us your blueprint. We'll go ahead and provision a cluster using this blueprint, you know, through in our private cluster here, and we'll be able to then take a look at what the customer's problem based on his exact configurations and topology. So this is something that's now, I think it's going to be released in Apache and Bari end of month now, and then soon to be followed in Sahara in the HTTP plugin. Right now, we don't have the exact syntax of the blueprint support in Sahara in the HTTP blueprint, I mean HTTP plugin. What we do have is we have something that's very similar. So you could almost do this right now with the HTTP plugin, where we have something very similar to a blueprint that it's JSON based and it was derived from the original blueprint specification. We make use of a feature within Sahara that allows plugin providers to have provider specific templates. What we do with that is from you upload this provider-specific template, and then it goes ahead and it creates your node group templates and your cluster templates. So if you don't wish to create these templates in the native manner through the Horizon tooling, you can instead upload the HTTP-specific template, and we'll go ahead and create the cluster and the node group templates for you. So, like I said, it provides an interesting use case between the physical and the virtualized worlds there, where you can repeatedly deploy a cluster based on a standard JSON template. And that's all I have right now for the HTTP plugin. So.
Okay, and the last slide, two slides, I think, is about Juno plans. We have a brief general roadmap for Juno to integrate with OpenStack ecosystem better. We have in a plan to integrate with Solometer and Ironic. With Solometer to publish some of our metrics, statistics about clusters, about Hadoop workloads, and et cetera. And Ironic will make us able to provision bare metal and hybrid clusters. That is a very interesting use case, too. Additionally, we are working on distributing Sahara to make it running in multiple processes, like other OpenStack projects. We're working on guest agents to remove direct access from the Sahara controllers to the Hadoop cluster nodes. Of course, we'll have some bunch of HDP enhancements, like new data sources, new job types. And as I say in the first slides, we're working on merging dashboards to the horizon. In fact, our roadmap will be discussed at the Design Summit. That will be in the end of the week, Tuesday afternoon and Friday morning. Additionally, we'll have two more talks about the Sahara. Talk about technical deep dive to the EDB functionality tomorrow and performance of Hadoop on OpenStack on Wednesday. So that's all. Thank you, and your questions? Yeah? Probably you should take a mic.
Can you elaborate a bit how this blueprint concept is related to Heat? And in general, what are your plans on leveraging Heat?
Sure. So they're independent. So Heat is a way that we actually go ahead and provision, do our back-end provisioning of the VMs. Blueprint is more of what is the topology of your cluster. So when you think of provisioning a cluster, it's in multiple phases. The first is you're provisioning the hardware, the VMs themselves, making sure they're set up. That's all done in Heat. That's a layer below Blueprint. So Blueprint comes in on top of that, where you have all your VMs set up, your networks all set up, and now you want to go ahead and lay down your Hadoop cluster. That's where Blueprints comes into play. So that it's basically the second phase could be defined by the Blueprint, which is basically an HTTP-specific template, cluster template. So you know, regardless of whether you're using a Blueprint, regardless of which particular plugin you're using, it's always going to use Heat unless you specify not to on the back end to provision your VMs. At that point, each plugin then provisions slightly differently. One of the ways that you can provision through the HTTP plugin is through a Blueprint template. Does that answer your question?
Okay, I have a question. On one of the slides, I think it was HDP 2.1, which is coming up. You mentioned Storm.
Yes.
Can you talk a little bit more about Storm and what your plans are with that?
Other than, so Storm, you know, is an app that we use within the YARN framework of HTTP 2.0, in this case 2.1. So it's a streaming API for doing real-time processing. So that, you know, that's going to be made available to users of the HTTP plugin through the one of our 2.1 HTTP stack. So I don't know if it's the right agenda to talk about the low-level details of what actually Storm is. For this talk, I think it's suffice to say that we make the 2.1 stack available to you, and as part of that stack, the Storm is available as a service, and based on you can deploy the service and its various components to your cluster via Sahara. That'll be available via a blueprint or through the standard cluster templates.
And from the Sahara point of view, we'll support Storm topologies as a part of EDP.
I got a little confused when you described the plugins and the main project Sahara. Can you specify a little bit more, you know, just briefly, you know, what are the new improvements that you plan to add to Juno from Icehouse? And what are the reasons you are adding these new additions to the project? Like, what are your plans for Juno, basically? What are your additions, the new things you want to add there?
Do you mean addition of new plugins?
Yeah, in the project, like our plugins or improvements to the project that you envision from Icehouse to Juno, moving on.
It's improvements. It will be improvements in all areas. We have plans on new plugins. We have plans on in changing our EDP stuff with a new job types, data sources. Probably updates for existing plugins with new versions. For example, for HDP plugins, 2.1 version with new services.
Is the instantiation of an HTTP cluster intended to be within the guests of a KVM hypervisor, or is it intending to leverage Iron to do bare metal deployments of the HTTP instances themselves?
Everything is deployed using Nova instances, so it depends on how your Nova services configured. For example, when we have the Ironic integration, or it will be integrated inside the Nova, we'll be able to provision bare metal and hybrid clusters. Currently, we're provisioning only virtual clusters.
Is there a capability to do them both at the same time, into the same environment, have a pod of Ironic deployed and a pod of virtualized?
Yeah.
What was that?
At some point, yeah.
I mean, we primarily use the Nova interface.
Okay.
So as soon as the Nova interface provides us with that capability, we can do it. We're not trying to circumvent or do something extra.
Well, actually, one of the things I'm trying to figure out for our environment is how we can build customized definitions of the blueprints so that we can direct that interface to say this segment needs to be on Ironic, this segment needs to be.
Yeah, we're planning to do it.
Is that actually in the descriptor for the JSON, or do we have to extend it to make it do that?
Yes, the JSON, I mean, the blueprint that I spoke of,
right.
that blueprint right
now is specific. It doesn't have any notion of virtualization. It's just basically topology. And then you have to then map that onto another layer, which is what do your VMs look like? What are your flavors? So there's going to have to be work to be done, but that's certainly a use case that we're looking at.
Do you have any plans related to Apache Spark? Do you have any plans related to Apache Spark?
Yeah, so I mentioned that we already have disk image builder elements to create images that have Spark. There's actually a Spark plugin that's under review right now. It was just updated again this morning, so there's good progress there.
Hi. So I think you mentioned about something that I wanted to ask. So other than the HTTP plugin? Do you have another example of plugin that you can elaborate a little bit more so that to help me understand the layer difference between the Sahara API and the underlying plugin?
So you're asking the relationship between the HTTP plugin and Sahara proper, is that?
Right, and I'd like to know if there are any other plugin that you can explain a little bit other than the HTTP one.
Any other what, I'm sorry?
Plugin. Any other plugin?
Oh, plugin. So yeah, we support. We have a generic plugin we support. And we have an Intel we currently support, but that's going to be, yeah. So the Intel distribution kind of went away. So, you know, that may or may not be around for a long period of time. So right now, it's basically HTTP generic and Intel. I'm not sure of the future of the Intel plugin based on the recent news with Intel, you know, kind of leaning away from that distribution. So your question with regards to the relationship between the plugins and the Sahara proper, so there's a formal contract between the two. Sahara is responsible for talking through heat, provisioning all your VMs. It understands cluster templates, and it basically creates your virtualized cluster. It's fully networked. At that point, the control's handed over to the plugin through an SPI, and it says, here's the topology. Here's the nodes. Here's your cluster topology, your Hadoop cluster topology. Here's the cluster topology, your VMs, etc. And then it's up to the plugin provider then to map that cluster topology onto your onto the appropriate VMs. Does that make sense?
Thank you.
So yeah. So they're very distinct steps between the plugin and Sahara proper. You know, the plugin is just basically. I basically have a bunch of nodes that I want to deploy Hadoop onto. That's what it does.
I think I understand more now.
Okay.
So I have a quick question regarding so Ambari monitoring piece, right, is going to be replaced by Ceilometer, or Ceilometer is going to stay as like very high level. I just trying to understand the plan for Ceilometer.
So about Ceilometer, we have two directions of integration with Ceilometer. First of all, we can post different statistics about number of created clusters, the life lengths of clusters, number of jobs per cluster, something like this, some statistics about Sahara objects. And the another one direction is to read some statistics from inside the cluster and repost them to Ceilometer, but only some very important statistics. We will discuss it on the design summit. So
it's not a replacement. You know, the Apache Ambari is very fine-grained monitoring of your cluster, where Ceilometer is a bit more coarse-grained, really. You can really drill down into very low-level details in Apache.
Yeah,
Ambari.
Monitoring inside the vendor tooling, like Ambari, will work as an addition to other tools.
Right. Yes, they don't replace each other.
Yeah.
So I have one question. So how does the UI look for this entire thing? So say, for example, the HDP plugin, does it have its own UI? Or is this all integrated into Horizon? So stuff like, you know, say job queues, or I want to know how the cluster is, or some of the graphs that you just showed, so were they as part of Horizon? Or did every plugin have its own UI for now?
The whole Sahara API is available through the Horizon, and we're posting links to Hadoop tools like Kuzi, like web UI for HDFS, as the links in Horizon, so you can just click the link and open the Hadoop-specific web management tools. For example, in Uzi, you can see how your jobs are running on cluster, and et cetera.
So that's how Apache Ambari is exposed. It's exposed as a link, so you click on the cluster you just provisioned, and there's a bunch of management links, and Apache Ambari would be one specific to the HTTP plugin. At that point, it brings you to the typical UI for Apache Ambari. Now you're outside of Horizon. It's not a pane within Horizon.
Okay, got it. Cool, thanks.
Thank you very much.